Well, good morning, everybody. Just checking that's on so that everybody can hear me. Can you hear me at the back? Yes. We're going to be playing some parts of the service a little bit more by ear, as they say, than, well, we are always playing it by ear here, aren't we? Sam has suddenly had to go to hospital with her mum, who wasn't feeling too well. Apparently there was a cracked rib earlier in the week.
Yeah, she had a cracked rib, and then I think she might have reacted to the
medicine.
So nothing to worry about, I think. But yeah, that's where she is.
But Sam quite rightly making that her priority. So children's address will be slightly different. And did Sam talk to you, Rosie, at all?
We're winging it.
You're winging it. That's what I like to hear. Sharnbrook winging it. And it'll be all the better for it. But we got some fun coming along for young people and adults when we're singing some songs later. Welcome. This is even somebody like myself who isn't particularly taken with the traditional church calendar. Nobody knows when Jesus actually entered Jerusalem. Sorry to puncture that balloon if you're really wedded on that. It comes down to one particular interpretation of one timeline of one gospel. Nevertheless, it is wonderful to spend the time to celebrate this particular time in Jesus' life and in the salvation story. So today we're going to spend some time obviously thinking about what's traditionally called Palm Sunday. Notices, hopefully you've got them electronically. There's one paper copy over there as well if you haven't had the time or you aren't connected to the internet. Next week, or this evening actually, this afternoon, we've got prayer and praise back here, and it's a special prayer and praise focused on the whole week, this last week of Jesus' earthly life leading up to the crucifixion and the resurrection and the empty tomb. And then on Wednesday, don't forget, it is our regular monthly prayer meeting here again. Let's remember, especially at this time, as we think to the future, about how important it is not just to be praying individually in our home, but to come together for corporate prayer. There's something special for us, I think, when we come together corporately in prayer and bounce our spirits off each other, as it were, as we build on each other's prayers. So let's come together next Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. here as normal. And then next Friday, obviously, it is Good Friday. I messed up with Alison. I didn't let her know the updates, which it isn't Martin Salter from Grace who'll be leading. It's myself. We decided together that given that the emphasis is on the village coming together to worship, it would be better me doing it, and Martin's going to come in a month or two's time. So it's been up there on the screen for weeks, but it's coming together here at 9 a.m. for a communion service, and then the walk with the cross down to the green, where we will be joining with the Anglican Church and other churches and people from across the village. And quite a few turned out last year, so let's hope for a good turnout and good witness and celebration together. And then, week today, Sunday the 31st of March, Easter Sunday, usual time, wonderful celebration here, and I'll be preaching again. And what have we got to remember? The clocks go forward 1 hour on Sunday morning. Spring forward. That means that if you don't sort your clocks, you'll be coming an hour late, and it'll be really embarrassing. So set your clocks forward 1 hour so that we're all here together to celebrate that wonderful Easter service. Now, on the Saturday, again, this is all on paper, but I want everybody to hear it as well. On Saturday, if you're up for it, we've got a church walk starting at our house and doing quite a long walk, 9:30 at our house. The walk is the loop round the river via Oakley back again. That's about 2.25 hours. But you don't need to do the walk to get lunch. You can turn up at noon at our house If you don't know where it is, talk to Ruth afterwards. And Ruth would quite like to know roughly how many people are coming. So don't talk to me about that. Talk to Ruth, because I'll forget who tells me if you haven't mentioned to Ruth. Yeah? But we'll take it at a fairly slow pace. So don't worry too much. If you can do about 2 hours of walk, come with us. Otherwise, meet with us for lunch afterwards. Enough of the notices, I think. Let's clocks forward, Sam. I've done all the main things. Geraldine, over to you.
Thank you. God is good, and however you come this morning, we know that God loves us very much, and he has a plan for us. And we can see that plan unfolding, his plan for salvation, all the way through the Old Testament. And this is what Zechariah wrote. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So let's come and in singing to praise our God reigns.
Seated on the
Please be seated. This was the spot where Sam was going to do the children's address. We'll be doing a little bit different. But let's pray now. Let's come to the Lord. Lord, we do thank you that as spring breaks out and new life comes and warmth in the sun hits us, our spirits physically get raised. And we thank you that at this time, as we look through Palm Sunday to Good Friday and Easter Sunday, that our hearts and our spirits can be raised as we come to celebrate, to remember, to praise you for you, who you are. Hosanna is the Son of David. We pray, Lord, that this Easter you might meet with us specially as we pause and remember this unique point in space and time when you broke open the way for mankind to be back with you. When the curtain in the temple was ripped into from top to bottom, symbolizing that all now through Christ could enter into the Holy of Holies and have that special relationship with God that we were made for in the Garden of Eden. We cannot tell everything that went on at this special time, Lord, but we do know that through it, you have made us your friends. Amen. Now, we were going to have lots of children here, and we planned lots of fun things. One of the things we plan to do, which we're going to continue to do, and all adults who wish to will be able to join, we're going to have some special songs that are all about Palm Sunday. Right. Adults can answer as well. Why do we call it Palm Sunday, this special day? Anybody know? You conferring? You can confer. Do you know why we call it Palm Sunday? Because the Bible tells us that as Jesus came towards Jerusalem, all the people were waving palm leaves. Now, Palm Sunday's become really special for me since I lived in Malawi. Because Palm Sunday, Ruth and I were in our little 4x4 driving from one of the cities called Blantyre down into the countryside. And you drop maybe 2,000 feet down the road. And as we were going down, we met, I don't know how many people it was, in my memory it feels like dozens and dozens and dozens of people walking to church, because everybody walks there, and they were walking on both sides of the road. And a lot of the women in these churches, they're in women's guilds, gatherings of women, and they always wear uniforms. They have white scarves on their heads, they have white coats, white shirts, and then they have over their dress, over their skirt, they have colorful cloth called Chianjano. And each denomination has its own colored cloth, Chianjano, a bit like Scots having clan tartans. And these people were walking towards us on both sides of the road, and guess what they had in their hands? Palm leaves, because there's palm trees in Malawi. And they were waving them, and it suddenly struck me what a wonderful sight it must have been on that first Palm Sunday, as Jesus came in on a donkey, and all the people celebrated as much as their hearts could be, waving these palm trees. A bit like, I don't know, Ben, what's your football team? I can hear it, come on.
Liverpool.
Oh, well, there's always one. Anyway, so at the, what's it called again? The stand, the famous stand, the Kop, isn't that right? The Kop. So, you know, at the Kop, they're all waving their flags, celebrating their team. That's what the people were doing, celebrating King Jesus coming into Jerusalem. So, as we sing the songs, we thought we would do a little bit of special celebration. And we have a selection of
some
maracas. And there's more than enough for the children.
Well, so, I have a few spare.
few spare, anyone going to join in?
If I had known, I would have brought my tambourine.
Yeah.
I've got a proper one.
A proper one.
Yeah, Salvation Army one, yes. Bring in next
time. Next year, we'll try and remember. Okay, anybody else want to join in?
Yeah, I'll at once.
Come on. I'll do it, there's nobody else with. Right. Are we all ready?
Yeah.
And those of us who can stand will, and you know, see what the beat looks like. You can clap, you can wave, just for a while, just this morning, just try and imagine what it was like for those folk to see Jesus walk in to Jerusalem. And let's celebrate. That chorus again, and then we'll go straight on. Men? Thank you. next year. So we've got to remember next year, bring the tambourine. Yeah. And I think we've got to get some flags or something next year so that we can be waving our imaginary palm leaves. Right, Helen's going to lead us in prayer, and then Trues is going to open the word for us. Thank you.
Let's come before the throne of grace. Loving Father, we praise you with grateful hearts this morning, undeserving as we are, that you should love us so much. This is how you loved the world, that you gave your one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but will receive eternal life. Jesus didn't come into the world to condemn us, but to rescue us. Father, as we approach Easter, and as we read your word, we read in your word of all the events those many years ago, may we become even more aware of your majesty, wonder, and love shown to us through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus. Thank you for sending Jesus as the ultimate sacrifice so that we can be in relationship with you. May we have eyes and hearts that look upon your grace and rejoice in our salvation. Show us how to repent of the things that try to keep us from you. We thank you, Father, there is not a thing that can separate us from your love. We are even more mindful of what it cost you to redeem us and bring us into your family. May we be reminded daily to depend on you, to honour you, and to put you first. We are sorry that we fall short of your mark every day, but we thank you for your grace and mercy to us. Renew us, Lord. Cleanse our hearts and draw us nearer to you. Father, help us to walk in that mighty grace and tell of your good news to the world and to each individual that we work with. May our minds, hearts, words, and actions glorify you. We pray for your worldwide church, that your disciples in every nation walk close with you and remain steadfast. You have promised that you will never leave us and that we should never be afraid. We pray for peace in the world and for the leaders of nations to act in a godly way, seeking to follow you in wisdom, compassion, and righteous leadership. We ask, Lord, that you would bring together people to seek solutions for troubled areas of the world, such as Ukraine and all the trouble in Israel and Gaza. Lord, we ask that you comfort the people who have lost loved ones this week in this terrible attack in Moscow. Open up our hearts, Lord, to the needs of others. May we reflect your love and compassion in our actions, serving those who are struggling in body, spirit, and mind. And we pray in particular today for those in our fellowship, our families, neighbours and friends who are struggling with illness, disability and sorrow, those undergoing or waiting medical tests or procedures. We ask for your peace upon them. We pray for our sister Ruth Register and her family as she settles into her new abode, and for Stella as she adjusts to a change in her dialysis treatment. Grant them comfort and peace. We continue to pray for the residents of the Sharnbrook Hotel as they seek a peaceful life here in the UK. And we give thanks for Wilson and Marlene, Geronimo and Samuel, part of our church family this last 12 months. We ask, Lord, for them to know your loving hand upon them. We pray for the young people impacted by the gospel message at Illuminate and LZ7 event at Sharnbrook Academy. Father, we pray that seeds will have been sown and that many young people will find their true hope in Jesus. And we do give you grateful thanks, Lord, that Charlie Westbrook is being baptized next Sunday. What joy that is, Lord, and please protect him and his family as they approach that day. Thank you for the 3-2-1 blast off Easter holiday club at All Saints, for Benjamin, Eleanor and Geronimo to have a wonderful time and learn more about Jesus. We do pray, Lord, that the leaders are given energy and patience as they lead that event. Thank you, Lord, for all the Sunday school teachers for their commitment week in, week out. And we pray, Lord, for our church and for the decisions to be made in the coming months as to what you want us to do. We continue to pray for unity and love between us. Thank you for our leadership team as they serve and seek to navigate us through all this. We give you thanks for the help and support from Grace Community Church. And this morning, Lord, we ask, please speak through Myles as he brings your word to us. May your word be a light to our feet and a lamp to our path. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We pray all of this in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
The reading this morning is Matthew chapter 21, verses 1-11. In the Church Bible, this is on page number 988. The Triumphal Entry. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell them that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken throughout the prophet. "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee."
Well, thank you very much, Helen and Trues, for your contributions there. So I've already mentioned that Palm Sunday took on a special interest for me after our Malawi trip because of that picture that just sticks in my mind. There's another way that there's some relation to this passage, because in this passage that we're going to unpack just for a few minutes, names are all important, as we'll see as we go through it. Names are all important. And in Malawi, names and the meaning of the names given to people are still really important. There's names like, well, the gentleman that I worked closest with was called Luckwell. Luckwell. And when parents give that name to the child, it's got a blessing for them that they're going to have good luck, that they're going to have well luck through their life. What were some of the others, Ruth? Loveness. Loveness. We might think of them as made up names, but they're very, very special names, and often they're the English version of some Chichewa names. Another very common one was Gift, which was a Chichewa name, and also the English. They meant something. When you were given a name, it meant something. It was a promise, just as it was in the Hebrew days. It was like a gift from the parents trying to say, this is about your character and your position and your role as you grow up and grow forward. MacBean, for example, my name in Scotland, again, names had meanings, like means son of fair one. I used to tell my children that it actually meant son of the good looking one, so that they got a feel of how good looking their father was. But actually, son of the blonde one or the fair one. So names have meanings. And in this passage, names are really important. The meaning of names is right at the center of the Bible. The Bible often will quote names of God to get over the character and the nature and the role of the people in the Bible. And this passage, called what we call Palm Sunday, or as our Bibles call it, the triumphant entry, must be really important because it's in all four Gospels. Very similar narratives in all four Gospels. God wanted it to be front and center in our lives as disciples. It's interesting, the first point that we'll be drawing out is that in Palm Sunday, the crowd poses, close to the end of our passage, the most important of questions, which we'll get to later, but you can skip ahead and look if you want. And the answer that we give to that question, personally, is probably the most fundamental answer, question and answer we can ever give in our lives. Forget your GCSEs, forget your A-levels. Oh, there's no A-level student here today, so I can say that. Forget your A-level, forget your degrees. This is the most important question and the most important answer that you can give in life. And secondly, as I've mentioned, the names for Jesus used in this passage cut right to the heart of the answer to that most important question. The answer to that question is buried in this passage for those who want to hear, regardless of how the crowds answered on that first Palm Sunday, regardless of how we might answer ourselves today, there is one right answer. As a physicist, I love that. As a mathematician, there's always one right answer in maths and physics. Unfortunately, not so in life. But here, there is one right answer to that fundamental question that the crowd asks. So this is a very famous passage, one we've read many, many times. Let's start by just looking at the story again and picking out some exceptions. And I typically have completely forgotten about the PowerPoint that I spent time putting together, so I'll catch up. Who is Jesus? That's the fundamental question that is asked this morning in the passage. Let's now look a little at the story, and you can tell me afterwards if Google got the Spanish right. Let's look at the importance of three things that come up in the story that sometimes, perhaps in our Western mind and our modern mind, we might skip over. Matthew, in verse 1 of the chapter that we read, picks up on the account at a place called Bethphage. Now, if you know your geography around Jerusalem, you've got the Mount of Olives and Bethphage, although there's a little bit of uncertainty, was probably just over, if you're looking out from Jerusalem, just over the lip of the hill of the Mount of Olives, the top of the Mount of Olives. So you wouldn't have seen Jerusalem quite from there, but you were very close to Jerusalem on your way. It's a small town. And it was a place that would already have meant something to the readers, because it's always been the Mount of Olives has always been linked in people's minds to King David. If you think back to the book of Samuel and 2 Samuel, when David returns from that exile, remember David is exiled because his son takes over and he has to flee Jerusalem. When he comes back, how does he come back? He comes back via the Mount of Olives. And the readers of this book and those who saw it happen would have been steeped in their Old Testament and would have seen this already. The picture would have been there already in their mind of the meaning of this, that Jesus chose to walk this way. And it's also got a lot to do with messianic prophecy as well. Because the prophecy is that in Zechariah 14, that on that day when God brings his Messiah, God's feet will stand on the Mount of Olives. The prophecy of the Messiah's coming is that God's feet, the Messiah's feet, will stand on the Mount of Olives. So you see what's happening here with Matthew's story and the history that was happening. The truth was being placed front and center in the minds, right in the faces of those who saw Jesus entering, if they had eyes to see it and ears to hear it. Now, at the center of the story, especially if you remember your Sunday school days, is the finding of the donkey. And in our rush and in our modern world, we might miss the significance of that. To me, it doesn't really matter too much whether Jesus had pre-planned it, and that's why he knew the donkey was there, or whether it was miraculous intervention that he knew that the donkey was going to be there. To me, that's neither here nor there, although my Sunday school teachers used to get very hooked on it. The fact is that the donkey was available. The disciples found the donkey, and Jesus rode in on Jerusalem on, what does it say, on the foal of a donkey, on a donkey that had never been ridden before. What must that really large crowd have thought as they looked on that? And again, there are echoes of this all the way through Scripture. Again, Jesus, by doing this, was fulfilling Scripture and putting the truth front and center to the crowd. The narrator is declaring that Jesus is the one who in Genesis 49, that far back in the Old Testament, there is a prophecy that one will come, shall come, the Lion of Judah will come, and he will be the one who ties and unties the donkey. Weird, but it's there. And for those Jews who knew their scripture inside out, and they would have, this would have been right in their face. The very fact that a donkey was untied and Jesus was riding on a colt meant something to that crowd. Second significant thing that came was this spreading of coats and branches. Now, I think in any culture we get the point of that, don't we? In today's day and age, perhaps the equivalent is the red carpet. You know, we roll out a red carpet. We once, when I was working in BT Labs in Suffolk, very early on in my career there, the then Prince of Wales, now the King, came to visit. And oh boy, everything was tidied up and everything was made clean and a red carpet was rolled out. And why was one of the people chosen to, when he was having his cup of tea, to be there to have a chat with the Prince? The only thing I can remember is he was really short compared to what he looks like on television, but we won't go there. But the red carpet was rolled out because he was important, and symbolically, you didn't want his feet to touch the dirt, did you? Another place I came across red carpets is when I was working for Disney. We used to get invited along to the premieres. And you didn't walk down with the stars, unfortunately. You walked down before the stars, but you got to walk down the red carpet. And it felt so very, very special. In all cultures, there's this idea of scattering rose petals in Walt Disney movies when the princess is walking down. The crowd took what was available, the coats off their own backs and the branches from the trees that were round about, and placed them on the ground. Verse 8, branches, cloaks on the road, and spread them on the road. They took what was to hand in their lives and they placed them on the road to worship this person, to honor this person. I wonder if our lives are like that. Do we take everything that's to hand, lay them down in front of the King? So the meaning is obvious to us even, but in the Hebrew mind, it had even more to say, because down through Scripture, this picture of placing branches down on the ground and cloaks were linked to a king. An example, 2 Kings chapter 9. They hurried and took their cloaks and spread them under King Jehu on the bare steps. Then they blew trumpets and shouted, "Jehu is king." The crowd were declaring Jesus as king. Jesus, in his service and in his ministry over these last 3 years, do you remember so often he would say to somebody who had been, where somebody, say, a beggar an invalid had been made whole, he would say what? "Quiet, don't tell anybody." Jesus was in a phase in his ministry where he wanted quietly those who had ears to hear through parables and all the rest of it. But time changed on this first Palm Sunday, and he was pulling back the cloak on who he really was, pulling back the veil, making clear who he really was. And the crowd recognized this in what they did, that he was the king. Date palms were also really special for Israel. The date palms were a symbol of the nationhood of Israel. They were on the coins of the day. So the palm leaves, again, had something special there. This wasn't just random. This was fulfillment of prophecy and in-your-face declaration of who Jesus was and is. And third, and perhaps most clearly, what do the crowd sing or shout? "Hosanna to the Son of David." Hosanna to the Son of David. Do anyone know what Hosanna actually means? Well, maybe it's in a footnote of your Bible. That would be cheating. Hosanna. Anybody? It means save now. Save now. Hosanna. Save now. At its core, the crowd were recognizing that to some extent they understood that Jesus was the Messiah, that Jesus was the promised King, that Jesus was the promised Savior. Jesus' name itself means Savior, like Joshua, Savior. And here, Hosanna, save now, Son of David, the King who is to come. Out of the mouth of babes, they say, did they really realize how Jesus was going to save? Did they really realize that the now in a week's time was going to be so radically different from what they probably thought? Hosanna to the Son of David. You see, they were an oppressed bunch. They were sitting there under Roman rule. They were pressed down, and their culture was being fought against by the Romans. People were going over to a Roman culture. The Jewish culture was being proscribed, a bit like you English did in Scotland after 1745. I don't know if you know this story, But after 1745, it wasn't just the English. The English and the Protestant Scots and the government supporting Scots said to the Highlanders, no tartan, no Gaelic language, no arms, no Celtic culture. And it was squashed out of us. And that's why people like me speak English and don't know Gaelic from Swahili. That's what was going on. And these people seemed to be desperate for a king, desperate for a savior, but not the one that Jesus was going to be. The whole city was getting stirred, but look at what they say in the end. Who is this? Who is this Jesus? You see, at one level, they seemed to recognize what was going on, but whether it was intentionally or because they weren't paying enough attention or because they just didn't want to hear, they were looking for a king, a messiah, a savior who fitted their plans and their ideas, not God's plan and God's ideas. So what lessons can we maybe find from the crowd this morning? First of all, as I've already said, the crowd wanted Jesus to be the kind of savior that they wanted. They wanted the kind of messiah, the kind of Christ that they thought they needed, not that God knew they needed. They wanted this earthly king, this son of God, David, who would be coming into Jerusalem like a Roman general in his triumph. Have you ever read or been taught in school about those triumphant entries of Roman generals into Jerusalem, of the Caesars? They were huge affairs. The general would ride in on a big charger. He would have a trail of all the defeated enemies behind him. The people would be cheering. Often in Rome, they were paid to be there and cheer. Sounds a wee bit like politicians today, doesn't it? And it would be a huge triumphant entry of a victory by the general for Rome. That's what they were after. And here, what did they find? They found a meek king on a donkey, proclaiming literally that he, in Matthew 20, just before our reading, that he did not come to be served, but to serve. Not to kill, but to give his life as a ransom for many. The crowd wanted a Jesus to be the kind of savior that they wanted, and they thought they knew they wanted, rather than the savior that God knew they needed. And then the crowd missed so many of the clues that Jesus had given. They had all the evidence in front of their faces, in front of their eyes. They heard the truth that Jesus had spoken, but they failed to see Jesus for who he was and who he is. I don't know if it was the darkness of their hearts or the suffocating weeds of world's priorities, but or maybe they just didn't pay enough attention. They got as far as asking the question, who is Jesus? But their reported answer is woefully inadequate. Look at verse 11. This is Jesus, what? The prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. They corrupted the obvious, and Jesus became a prophet rather than the prophet, the Messiah, the King of Kings, the Son of David. And within a week, this Passover crowd, Matthew records as saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, is instead in chapter 27 shouting, crucify him, as Jesus failed to meet their expectations. And we're told that the crowd voted for who to be released from prison. Somebody who was absolutely bent as a zealot on trying to physically and worldly release them from Roman captivity. They failed, Jesus failed to meet their expectations. And the crowd also seemed to miss that Holy Spirit-inspired insight that Peter had when he was asked a very similar question. You remember it earlier in Matthew 16. Jesus turns to his disciples and he says, "Who do you say I am?" And it's as if the Holy Spirit broke in and opened Peter's eyes to the truth that he had been seeing, just as these people, as Jesus entered, were seeing the truth displayed before them. But the difference is Peter recognizes Jesus for the Messiah he truly is. "You are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." He saw him for who he was, fully Son of David and Son of God, fully man and King, Son of David and Son of God, Lord of Lords, man and God, fully come to reality, come to full display as Jesus rode on a donkey into Jerusalem in his final week. What can we take away from this so well-known passage? I think there's both challenges and encouragements here, my friends. Are you still trying to force Jesus into your mold? You know, one of our most fundamental challenges as mankind is we think we know what's right, like that crowd. We think we know the kind of Messiah that we need, and we continue to try to force him into our mold. That's perhaps most the case before we are believers and before we come to Christ, when the world is all we know and crowd in. And I don't know about you, but as I get longer in the tooth as a disciple, I just look at my friends around about and I wonder, how can they survive without knowing the truth of Jesus as their Savior and that hope of eternity that comes? No wonder we're at a stage where the data that I just saw in the newspapers yesterday, the most recent results show that up to a quarter of young people have some form of mental health. And for girls, it goes up to 30% because of the pressures and the turmoils of this world. And people are so tempted to look elsewhere for their hope and their salvation, to look for a Messiah that fits their thoughts and their needs. But my brothers and sisters here, sometimes as disciples, we are so similar as well. We read into Scripture the message we want to hear, rather than reading Scripture for the message that God wants us to hear. And we read in our preferences and our characters and even our learning styles. You know, if our character is to be a bit more on the legalistic side of the spectrum, we think, "Oh, this gospel is still too easy." If we're more of the relaxed, let go and let God type characters, we'll say, "Oh, I don't like the bits where God is making clear we have to be intentional," and we'll try and write out that bit of the gospel. If we're mind-oriented and we think we're brainy, then we probably think, "Oh, this gospel's too simple, there must be more to it." If we're all emotion, we probably think, "Oh, this gospel's too hard, you've got to think about it." You see what I mean? So often we take our characters and our preferences and we read it into the gospel and look to make the gospel what we want it to be, rather than it is. My friends, if this Easter God does not shock you and surprise you, then you don't know him. If we think we have tamed the lion, and we get to a position where we see God following what we expect, then we don't really know him. He is a God who refuses to be structured by our thinking. And the beauty of opening his word every day is that he will continue to surprise and shape us, no matter how long we have walked with him. Are you trying to force Jesus into your mold? Have you recognized Jesus for who he really is? Have you, whether you're still looking to come to Jesus for the first time or you're seeking to continue to follow him, have you got the right answer to who do you say I am? Let's throw off all our expectations as disciples or seekers and dive deep into the Word of God, where through the Holy Spirit we can know God's character through Jesus and know him for who he is, God Christ anointed one, Jesus our personal Savior, and that he is Lord of our lives. At the center of Easter is of course that famous passage, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes on him shall not perish but have eternal life. Only then, as we open our hearts to the Messiah as he truly is, as God wants us to recognize him, will we have what John says in John 10:10, is that true life in all its fullness. And then we can truly do what that crowd did on the first Palm Sunday. We can demonstrate to those around us our absolute joy in welcoming Jesus into our lives, fully recognizing that he is King, that he is Savior, and day by day saying, Hosanna, save now. Knowing Jesus as somebody who is saved once and forever, and somebody who daily is saving us through the Holy Spirit as he sanctifies us as we walk with him through life, laying every aspect of our lives at his feet, that he can in one way trample over them, but then, to stretch the metaphor, give them back as even more glorious cloaks and flags to live out our lives as witnesses to that King on a donkey who came to suffer for us that we might have eternal life. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that when we open your word and we come to you with honest, open hearts and ask that you reveal your message from Scripture, rather than us trying to take it to Scripture, the message that we want to hear, that you can explode in our hearts and our souls. We pray, Lord, that you will make us more ready to listen to you, to know you as you truly are, rather than we would make you in our minds, that you might continue to transform us into being in your image, that those around about might see in our hearts the hope and the joy that comes through knowing who you really are as Savior and Lord, who bridged the gap through the cross between fallen mankind and ever-loving God, that we might see you as master and that you might have us as friend. Help us this week to have words or deeds that shout out as if we are walking down Sharnbrook with palms in our hands, and be ready with an answer when people ask, who is this Jesus, that in word and deed points to the truth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I forgot to pull out the slides again. And who do you say I am? We're now going to finish with a couple of final songs, again, that talk into this wonderful time.
Down your life, for greater sound.
That might be true in our hearts, that we live every minute of every day, every relationship in our lives, with every gift that you have given us for you, and to celebrate your majesty, your power, your glory, your love, your compassion, what you did through your Son on earth, on cross, resurrected and on high, that your Son might bring us, that we might be close to your throne forevermore. Amen. We're Brian and I are just going to give some notices now, as we signaled, I think, last week. Some updates on progress around the review and the thinking towards the future. And then we will, youngsters in particular, don't worry, we will then have biscuits and juice and coffee and tea after that. And we won't take too long. Brian.
We wanted to provide feedback from the survey. You'll remember, I'm sure, that a few weeks ago we asked everybody to give us an indication of whether we are committed together to go forward and seek a new pastor or not. First of all, I want to apologise for the delay in coming back to you. We're mindful that it is a number of weeks since that point, but Myles has been incredibly busy as he's been coming to the end of his work, not only here, but also travelling around the world, Malaysia and various places. So we've really not had much time to consider the results and get to this point, so apologies for that. However, we were incredibly pleased with the level of response that we did have. So just give you some figures so that you're aware of the situation. Of the 25 church members, 21 responded, and of the 32 people that we emailed, 26 responded. Now, several people who didn't respond were nevertheless members of families or households that did respond. So the response was, in that sense, even better than those numbers probably suggest. In total, there were 28 responses, and all but two have personally committed to the calling of a new pastor. So, as a leadership team, we are very much encouraged by that, and we do intend to go forward in seeking a new pastor. We also asked whether people could nominate people, put names forward for a potential search group. So Myles and I and Sam have been mindful that it's just been the three of us, and we feel as though it'd be appropriate for others to join us in the next stage of now going out and seeking the right man. So we asked for names to be suggested. In total, seven names were suggested. And each of those were suggested by at least three people. Now, we had been thinking maybe two or three extra people, so seven has given us something to consider. And we will now be talking to those seven people and considering the best approach to go forward. Obviously, we've got Easter coming up, but after Easter, the leadership team will get together, and at that point, we will also start to think about meetings in the diary for the search group to get together and start to take this forward. If you've got any questions, Myles and I will be around after for tea and coffee. Please do grab us. An email will be going out so to make sure that anybody who isn't here gets the same information, and just to confirm the information I've just shared with you.
So I don't know about you, but I think that's really good news. The way that the church has come together over these months, some of us probably thinking, oh, it could have gone faster. Others thinking, oh, why are we taking so long? But really coming together in our views of what we are aspiring to as a church, where our strengths are, and the sort of folk, sort of person that we would look to call as a pastor. We're tentatively moving forward on this because anything and everything could change, and we want to be sensitive to the leading of God as we move forward. And more news will come. But I personally am beginning to feel, I'm feeling very positive about this, especially since I've had feedback from two or three of the pastors around, ministers, vicars, pastors, whatever the church tradition says, who have unprompted said how important they feel having a gospel witness in Sharnbrook is to North Bedfordshire. Because we are one of the bigger conurbations, because of the high school here, and our continuing prayer that out of Illuminate, we might be able to, facilitate and encourage something starting here in the church itself. Out of the Illuminate young people, most of them were from the Risley, Northampton area, not Risley, Rushton, Northampton area. But eight of them come to the school, who have come forward and continued with the program. So Sam and I and the rest of you, I'm sure, please pray for those youngsters that perhaps it might cause a spark here in the school. Mm-hmm. Talking about young people's lives, earlier in the month, there's a bit of news. Sam would have loved to have been here to mention this herself, but she wanted me to continue to mention this. Sam and Rob have been thinking long and hard about their future, and Sam gave the leadership team her notice that she will be resigning as youth and children's worker at SEC here at Sharnbrook by mid-July, in mid-July, at the end of the summer term before the school holidays. You can imagine Sam and Rob, they love Sharnbrook. This is not because of any dissatisfaction with what's going on. It's because they've been thinking deeply as a family about what would be best for them. Sam, in particular, has found it increasingly difficult to be part of two churches and doing justice to the family ministry and the young people's ministry in both centres, and also for the family to be sort of pulled between two church lives. And I think that's been the main driver. And as Benjamin gets older, he's in school there, he's got his friends there, it's all the more important to settle down, Sam and Rob think, in one place. And so Sam will continue to come to Sharnbrook one Sunday a month through to the end of summer term, and then they'll be making Risley their permanent church home. We'll have a time to say a proper farewell to Sam and to Rob and to Benjamin over this summer season, and we will. We'll make sure of it. Nobody leaves without a ritual embarrassment who's been part of this church. However, I know that the leadership team and the trustees and the whole of the fellowship will want to express our thanks to God for all that Sam has done over the years here, and the high regard we hold her in, and just the magic that she has in being able to communicate with children and young people. Now, our winter review said that we really do aspire to be a church that reaches out to children and young people, and also is a place for children and young people. We'll have to think long and hard as a fellowship about what that looks like in the very short term, and in the longer term, we'll have to factor that in to the sort of person and people that we're looking to call to be the leaders of the church. I know it's probably come as a little bit of a shock to you. I don't think anybody really expected this, but I can fully understand it. I'm sure you can. And we can wish the family every blessing as they resettle. I also had deep suspicion that we won't have heard the last of Sam when they move, because there is a lot going on through Illuminate, through work of the Church of England's diocese and the like, to pull churches together in children and youth work. And I'm sure we'll continue to be part of that as it emerges. Okay? I feel like I should just pray for the family before we go off to our coffee and biscuits. Lord, we just reiterate in our minds, in our hearts, what we've already said, that we'd so thank you for the time that Sam and Rob and Benjamin have been here with us at Sharnbrook. We in particular thank you for Sam's service to us, the way that she has always gone the extra mile, done so much more than might be required, and been so wonderful through the gifting that you've given her in engaging with children and young people. We know that she'll continue to be a blessing to her family and to the church where she at Risley, where she is settling with her family, and we pray that you will continue to allow her to minister to children and young people in this area for your kingdom's sake. Amen. Right, Kathy.